Hello. Happy politics and policy. Are you all settled? My name is Nina Krusheva. I'm Associate Dean of the Milano School here at the New School. We are introducing, once again, I mean, we're reintroducing many times over now, the Politics and Policy Series, which is organized by Jeff Smith. Mostly he's over there. I will bring him to the podium slightly later. But the series is important, and it actually attests to almost full house here. It connects this great excitement of day-to-day political horse race that we're experiencing now, but we're also trying to look at the deeper issues that face American democracy. And we've had various conversations already on this stage, continuing struggle to have voting rights for all, rise of insurgent candidates, which is a sign of deeper economic and cultural anxieties and mistrust of the government. You know, this conversation about why Bernie Sanders or Donald Trump really make it to the top of the candidates' ladder has been discussed and rediscussed. The broken campaign finance system, which allows just a few billionaires to dictate and set the agenda in Washington, always a huge problem for American democracy. And since I teach propaganda, the most favorite of mine is the contradictory phenomenon of fact checkers. There are so many of them right now. The media fact checkers is the this kind of going up and down, who lied more. And at the same time, the emergence of candidates who make blatant pronouncements and repeated pronouncements of not truth. Trusted is one of really, as propaganda teaches us, the minute you have trust or believe me in the candidate's speech, that is certainly an indication of a lie. And that yet it is Ted Cruz's campaign slogan, which Donald Trump disputes, saying that Ted Cruz is the biggest liar. At the same time, one of fact checkers actually recently said that fact checking Donald Trump is a totally useless exercise because actually there is no facts there whatsoever. So how do these contradictions bear on the future of American democracy? And would the country be able, from such an absolute extreme in the campaign, eventually form a national government and really function viably in the near future? So these are the most critical issues that we address in our series in anticipation of November 2016. Of course, in discussing those issues, we try to be topical and substantive, but you know, given the current electoral climate, it's not always an easy task. But we do that, or try to do that, because our top-notch experts, and you see the whole variety of them out there, on stage, the ones we welcome tonight, these are the really sharpest practitioners and observers of American politics. So we're very grateful that you're here to discuss important issues with us. So I thank you for being here, but also would like to thank the audience for spending this really warm evening. Welcome, winter 2016. So thank you for attending our event tonight. And my special thank you goes to Jeff Smith, who I now am going to introduce. He's a professor of politics at the Milano School, and he has organized most of the panels, in fact, almost all the panels, and now is going to moderate this very high esteemed one. So, Jeff, the floor is yours. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dean Krusheva. Really appreciate the generous introduction. That should dispel the fiction that Dean Krusheva doesn't know what she's doing. She knows exactly what she's doing. So the former Speaker of the California General Assembly, once famously said that money is the mother's milk of politics. And most of us have heard that quote. Yet another quote, though, that is a little bit less celebrated. And I'm going to read that open by reading that tonight. He said to an aspiring candidate for the legislature who asked him, "Mr. Speaker, do I have what it takes to run for the General Assembly?" And the speaker turned to him and said, "Look, if you can't drink a lobbyist's whiskey, eat his steaks, take his money, sleep with his women, and then wake up and vote against him in the morning, then you got no business running for office." And in some respects, this argument is the very argument that Hillary Clinton is making against Bernie Sanders, and the very argument that most of the Republican field is making against Donald Trump, as Bernie Sanders rails against the special interests in politics, and Donald Trump claims, a little bit falsely, to be a purely self-funded candidate. 13 years ago, I ran for the United States Congress. And when I ran the start of my campaign, it was a very difficult race. I ran against the son of a two-term governor of Missouri. His father was a governor, his grandfather was a congressman, and his mother was a U.S. senator. And since my dad had been a golf coach and then an advertising man, and my mom a special needs teacher, I had an uphill battle. And I remember the first solicitation letter that I wrote. It went out to a large group of people, and one of the persons who got it was my 95-year-old grandmother's bridge partner. And she came to the bridge game that week waving the letter, and she said, "Ida, I just got a solicitation letter from your grandson. He's running for Congress. Where do I send a check?" And my grandma replied, "If I were you, I'd save your money." For the next year, I spent 6 to 8 hours every day calling perfect strangers, usually, and asking them for money, $1,000 at a time, locked in a call room surrounded by two or three young people who were dialing the numbers and then giving me the phone as soon as someone actually agreed to talk to me, which was regrettably rare. I learned a lot during that year, but I didn't really like everything I learned. For example, I learned to walk into a room and immediately see dollar signs floating above the heads of people. I would estimate exactly how much money they had and how much they might be willing to give. I even did this with old and close friends. I remember I learned another lesson on a trip to Boston. I went up about an hour north of Boston to Portsmouth, New Hampshire, and I met with a woman who had run for Congress who was very wealthy. A friend of mine and a former student of mine actually introduced us and said, "You know, sit down with her and talk to her. She's big on the environment." So I had breakfast with her at a place called the Friendly Toast in Portsmouth, and I told her all about my stances on clean water and clean air and other issues which had earned me some praise from the League of Conservation Voters. And after about 30 minutes, she seemed to get bored, and she looked at me and she said, "Look, I'm sure you're great and everything, and I'm sure your stances are fine. How can I help you?" And I looked at her and I said, "Well, I was just wondering if maybe you could maybe write, you know, make a contribution to my campaign would be great. Any amount would be great. Thanks." And she said, "Look, I'll write you a check, but I will never, ever, ever support you again unless you learn how to ask someone for money. When you want money from someone, you look them in the eye, you tell them why you need it, and then you say, 'I need you to write me a check for $2,000, and I need you to do it today.' Do you understand that?" And I said, "I think so. Can your husband do $2,000 too?" So it was a steep learning curve. But once I became a Missouri senator, 2 years later, my experience was almost the exact opposite. Gradually, I found myself calling personal donors and individual donors for money less and less. The people who had powered me to victory, about 3,500 people who had donated to my campaign, my average contribution was about $27, actually. But I didn't want to bother them anymore. I didn't want to call them and bother them because it was easier, once I was a senator in Missouri, to just call lobbyists. Why? because they never said no. My main takeaways from all this, first of all, was just the incredible symbiosis between elected officials and well-funded special interests. Secondly, the amount of time that is spent by any by just about any campaign, Bernie Sanders has been amazing in his ability to eschew, for the most part, this side of the campaign. But the huge amount of time that most candidates are not able to spend on policy or meeting voters in their district or learning more about their district because of the amount of time they spend asking for money. And third, the fear and apprehension that only wealthy people or those who had huge networks of wealthy people would be able to run for office. The year after I got elected to the state senate in Missouri, they took all campaign finance limits off. It became the only state in the country where there are no limits on either donations or gifts that lobbyists can give to politicians. A few of us fought against that, but only a few. And Missouri is now the only state with no limits on anything. And if you look at all the legislators who have been caught up and been in the news for campaign finance related and other shenanigans, myself included, then I think you'd probably agree that it's not, this experiment has not worked out so well for Missouri. And yet, what we're seeing on the federal level these days in the wake of Citizens United and Free Speech Now, the two Supreme Court decisions we'll hear a bit more about tonight, really essentially gets us closer and closer to a system of anything goes. As we talk about in the title of this program, the new Wild West. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce the panelists who will be helping us think through this. We are joined by an amazing group of people. Before I do that, though, I just want to acknowledge the people who have sponsored tonight's event, the Milano School of International Affairs, Management, and Urban Policy. And I'd like to just give a quick shout out to our dean, Michelle DePass. Dean DePass. Thanks for being here. And also the Center for New York City Affairs. Kristen Morris, their executive director, could not be with us tonight, but several of their staff, as well as Milano students, have helped put together the logistics. And so thank you to all of you. So now I'd like to introduce our distinguished panel. First of all, closest to me, we have Zach Allen. Zach started a consulting firm, TIPA, did I pronounce that right? TIPA Consulting. Focused on fundraising and development strategy, based here in New York City after having served as finance director for the Democratic National Committee for the New York region in the 2014 cycle. He was responsible for oversight of one of the nation's wealthiest areas and largest political fundraising constituencies, and he's also put together fundraising events for U.S. Senators Kay Hagan, Mary Landrieu, Mark Pryor, as well as several Senate candidates. Prior to that, Zach was deputy finance director for the same region for President Obama's 2012 reelection campaign and worked in political consulting prior to that. Zach, thanks for being here tonight. Next, Adam Smith. Adam Smith is communications director for Every Voice, a national organization working to raise the voices of everyday people in politics. He's worked in money and politics advocacy since 2006, managing or advising communications efforts for policy, ballot initiative, or electoral campaigns at the federal and state levels throughout the country. And in 2012, have you guys seen the picture of Hillary Clinton? Like, she, I guess she's on, is she on?
She's on the G6, whatever that is, that plane, the like bomber thing, whatever that is.
She's on a military plane.
She's on a military plane and she's texting on her BlackBerry with the sunglasses on? Well, this guy's the one who made that picture famous by creating the text from Hillary Tumblr. So, quite a claim to fame.
Were you at Every Voice?
Next, we have Professor Christina Greer. Professor Greer's primary research interests are racial and ethnic politics, American urban centers, presidential politics and campaigns and elections. Her book, Black Ethnics, Race, Immigration, and the Pursuit of the American Dream, investigates the increasingly ethnically diverse black populations in the U.S. from Africa and the Caribbean, and was the recipient of the W.E.B. Du Bois Best Book Award in 2014, given by the National Conference of Black Political Scientists. Professor Greer is currently writing her second manuscript on the history of all African Americans who have run for president. We know about Shirley Chisholm, but I think there's about 55 or so others who Professor Greer is researching. She received her BA from Tufts and her master's and PhD from Columbia University, and is now associate professor of political science at Fordham University. Next, Raj Goyle. Raj was a bit delinquent in sending me his bio. In other words, it got here about 20 minutes ago. Raj, like me, is a Midwesterner. I'm from Missouri. Raj is from Kansas. Also, we were both in state legislatures together. Raj was in the House in Kansas. I went to school at the University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill. He went to school at a little junior college 8 miles down the road in Durham. Then he went to Harvard Law School, and after that was one of the earliest staffers at the Center for American Progress, where he worked with John Podesta, now Hillary Clinton's campaign chairman, on a wide variety of matters and led their immigration policy. He won arguably the toughest state House seat in the country in 2006. That is, it had one of the lowest percentages of Democrats in the whole country, in Wichita, Kansas, home to the Koch brothers. And the district had never elected a Democrat until Raj won there. He then ran the Kansas caucus for Obama in 2008. He was reelected that year and then ran for Congress in the bloodbath year of 2010 for Democrats, which is why he's here in New York right now instead of DC. He then went on to raise $2 million, more than $2 million of individual contributions. That's $2,300 at a time for President Obama's 2012 reelection. He moved millions of dollars as well for Senate candidates and other races in 2012 and 2014. He is also National Board Chair of the State Innovation Exchange, the leading progressive organization that focuses on state capitals, and is now the founder and CEO of the top tech company in the legal space, Badhala. Raj, thanks for being here tonight. Next to Raj, we've got Ken Vogel. Ken Vogel tracks the confluence of money, politics, and influence for POLITICO. He's the author of, bear with me here, Big Money, $2.5 billion, One Suspicious Vehicle, and a Pimp, On the Trail of the Ultra-Rich Hijacking American Politics, which chronicles the characters and motivations behind the explosion of unlimited money in politics after the Supreme Court's Citizens United decision. He's covered politics and government at all levels, from small-town cop shops and school boards to Congress and the presidential campaign trail. Before joining POLITICO, he reported for several regional papers as well as the Center for Public Integrity, and spent 2006 learning about Congress from the inside through an American Political Science Association fellowship that let him work on the staffs of two House committees. He's analyzed politics on CBS, CNN, Fox, MSNBC, NPR, and stations throughout the country. Thanks for coming up from Washington, Ken. And then finally, we have my good friend and fellow Missourian who traveled with us all the way from South Carolina, Jack Oliver. Jack is a senior advisor to Barclays and provides counsel for top clients around the world. He's cultivated relationships with top venture capital firms. You didn't tailor this biography for this event, did you?
I never changed my biography.
For top venture capital firms, and has served as senior advisor to companies including Palantir Technologies, OpenGov, Adapar, and Rubicon Global. He's worked as vice chairman of the Bush-Cheney 2004 campaign and previously as deputy chairman of the Republican National Committee and national finance director for the Bush for President campaign in 2000. He also serves as senior advisor to Brian Cave, an international law firm based in St. Louis, and is actively engaged as a member of numerous philanthropic organizations, including co-chair for the past 2 years of the One campaign, founded by U2's Bono and supported by the Gates Foundation, which works to raise public awareness about global poverty and disease in the developing world. Thanks again for coming up from South Carolina, Jack. So why don't we start where we just finished? And Jack, why don't you tell us a little bit about your take, given your role as co-chairman, which I didn't add to the bio, thank you, Minnie, as co-chairman of the Jeb Bush presidential campaign, just up from being with both Jeb and his brother, the president, in South Carolina. Give us your take both on big picture, money in the 2016 campaign, given that you've raised more of it than any human being alive, and also what you just saw.
Well, thank you, Jeff, and thanks to you all for letting me be here. I wore a red tie just in case anybody forgot that I was the Republican on the panel. So I do have the red tie on in case you forget. Is this working? Can you all hear me? Yes. So, as Jeff said already, only Jeff Smith could get me out of South Carolina here tonight. So I'm thrilled to be here and to have this opportunity to talk with all of you, and I know it will be a wonderfully entertaining session. So it's a very interesting, it's a political cycle like none I've ever seen before. It's whether it's Donald Trump or Bernie Sanders. It's no one could have predicted this. No one could have thought this was going to happen. And it's very interesting because what usually happens in political campaigns is you have a candidate, he or she goes out and raises resources at the every level possible, up to $2,700 per person on the federal side. They go out and they put policy papers out, and they have discussions about issues, and there's a back and forth. These debates end up being important because they're kind of theoretically conversations about issues. Well, what we basically have in this election cycle is everybody's really mad, and the only way you're successful is if you can be more angry than everyone else. Policy is not relevant. I mean, we've not really had a policy conversation it's really more about can you insult somebody, can you call somebody a name, can you make up some salacious something about them and see if CNN, CNBC, or Fox will cover it. And so it's been a really interesting time to be involved in this, and it's very interesting to watch because it's been more engaged from people all across the country, I think, than any other time in history since I've been doing this. And kind of all the rules are out the window. It's like, so if you said, okay, I'm going to go take a theory or I'm going to take something and back test it against history, every kind of rule of politics that existed in the last cycles, it's out the window. And so it's been very interesting to watch the rise of Donald Trump and what the role that Twitter has played in this campaign, which I think people underestimate. As well as a socialist from is that the right term? I don't know.
Democratic
socialist.
Democratic socialist from from Vermont who has over 2 million people who have contributed to his campaign, which is extraordinary. And to be taking on the most formidable money machine in Democratic politics ever, the Clinton group. So it's been really interesting to watch, and not so interesting to be involved in every day. But I love my friend, and I'm really proud of him and what he's done to continue to stand for the things he stands for, even though there is lots of people that want him to do other things, and it's been a real honor to do it as a volunteer. So I'll be happy to talk about any other topics you all want to in the future.
Well, good, and rest assured, another friend of mine who is a Republican just walked in, so you're not the only
one
in the room.
Thank you, wherever you are.
Yeah, he's in the back.
You're in the witness
protection. Are you wearing
program.
A red tie?
You're in the witness. So it's the funniest thing because it's one of the things we've been saying to everybody, because everybody's complaining about Trump, but no one will take him on, and Jeb's the only one who's been willing to take him on. And our theory has been, okay, well, why is everybody? Are y'all in the witness protection program? I mean, every time we're back in the green room, if we go out, everybody's complaining about him, and yet when you go on stage, it's like you don't even say anything. You want to point out the fact of. And it's been fun to watch that.
Did Christie take him on at all?
No, a little bit. Governor Christie had another target at the last debate.
Who was that?
We believe Jeb had really. This was the biggest exchange that we'd had with him last debate. So.
Governor Scott Walker from Wisconsin took him on early on, and you see what happened to him.
Yeah, right. Pretty much everyone. And Perry took him on early on, and that didn't work very well either. So Ken, you followed money. This has been basically the last decade or so of your career, pretty much.
So I'm going to say something before. This is the person you don't want to call you. If you're working on a campaign and he calls you, it's the person you don't want to talk to. So I had to get a signed waiver to sit here with him tonight, just so you know. I will tell you, he is one of the best reporters. A lot of people in this business, reporters, they don't take the information they put out seriously because it's so much easier to write salacious stuff. This is a real pro, and you're going to hear from tonight.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Given what Jack just said, you've done a fantastic job of not just reporting about money, but connecting money to policy in the country. And you've also done some pretty amazing investigative reporting. I think weren't you undercover at one of the Koch brothers retreats?
True fact.
Okay. So tell us. First, give us your broad impression of money here this cycle, and then tell us that story about being undercover.
All right. Well, thank you very much for the kind introduction. Thank you, Jack, as well. And thanks for having me here, Dean Kresheva and Dean DePass. It's a great topic, very interesting one. A lot of people are kind of wringing their hands over the explosion of money in politics, over the rise of Bernie Sanders, the rise of Donald Trump. You heard Jack bemoaning a little bit. From a purely a news perspective, it's kind of a great election. I selfishly admit it's super exciting. There's a lot to write about. Big money, though, is a trend that will be continue to be influential, was influential, will continue to be influential after this election, despite some of the very specific dynamics that are in play here that have led to the rise of Bernie Sanders and Donald Trump. So I wrote this book, Big Money. It came out in 2014, and people asked me when I was publicizing it and out doing the media hits, what's so different? Big money has always played a role in American politics. And that's true. You know, you can go back to the late 1800s. The robber barons were hugely influential in helping elect William McKinley president. You go all the way up to 2004, where the liberals were really at the vanguard of injecting huge sums of money into politics. George Soros, Peter Lewis, spent upwards of $200 million, them and a handful of other very wealthy liberal billionaires, trying to defeat George W. Bush, obviously not successful in that case. So what is different now? Well, what's different is the way the money is being spent is not necessarily the way that the party leaders, the folks who used to control, really have an iron grip on politics, want it to be spent. The robber barons, they were supporting William McKinley. He was who the Republicans wanted to be their presidential nominee and their president, and he was as a result. In 2004, George Soros and Peter Lewis, they were spending money trying to defeat George W. Bush. That's what the Democratic Party bosses wanted. So fast forward to the 2010 Citizens United decision, and suddenly the parties were substantially less influential in controlling the process, not just because of this decision that allowed very wealthy folks to spend unlimited sums however they wanted, not through the party, through their own operatives, but also there was sort of a countervailing effect where the parties were limited in what they could raise and what they could spend. There was a 2002 law, McCain-Feingold, that limited the party. So the combination of McCain-Feingold and Citizens United, suddenly the party bosses were much less influential in determining how this money was going to be spent. And you had extremely wealthy folks who, either out of loyalty to a candidate or passion for a cause, or maybe even to some extent self-interest, bottom line self-interest, decided, you know, I don't really like what the Republican Party is telling me to spend my money on, or I don't really like what the Democratic Party is telling me to spend my money on. I'm going to spend money on whatever. So you see Ted Cruz, you know, for all his inveighing against the donor class, four of the top six biggest donors in the 2016 cycle are behind Ted Cruz. They spent tens of millions of dollars supporting his campaign. The party leaders don't want that. They don't want Ted Cruz to continue to hang around and be a force and potentially beat Jeb Bush or Marco Rubio, John Kasich, some of these candidates who they would prefer to be the nominee. Rather, they would prefer that money to go and support Jeb Bush or John Kasich. Instead, you have these rogue billionaires who are able to pump money into the process through super PACs or non-disclosing nonprofit groups where we never really find out where the money came from. And they are making a huge mess of the process from the perspective of the party leaders and the establishment folks like Jack. They're really kind of throwing a monkey wrench into things. So you see this play out in elections, and some people are looking at the examples of Donald Trump and Bernie Sanders and saying, oh, this new big money means nothing because someone can run against the big money like Bernie Sanders or Donald Trump and really make an impact. But I think it still is really influential, both in elections, helping folks like Ted Cruz win the Iowa caucus, and also in policy, as Jeff alluded to. The way that the Koch brothers, for instance, have created almost a shadow Republican Party that is pulling the Republican Party to the right on certain issues like, you know, fiscal issues, government regulation, taxation, et cetera, and in other ways kind of upsetting the traditional partisan orthodoxies by, say, for example, really putting a lot of money into supporting criminal justice reform was not an issue that Republicans were really very big on until the Kochs made it one. So the Republican Party as well would prefer the Kochs just write their big checks to a party or a party-related operation instead. They're taking their money and their spending into their own hands, and it's having a huge impact on American politics in a way that even if a Bernie Sanders wins is inaugurated as president on January 21st, 2017, or Donald Trump is, and there will be an inclination for people to say, look, the big money wasn't that impactful. I think it's incredibly impactful, and we're going to see it continue to be impactful in the way that Congress and in the way that state legislatures around the country debate issues and the way the parties and their candidates line up on issues. So that's sort of my two cents on the big picture.
Thanks, Ken. And before we leave you, since you alluded to criminal justice reform, an issue near and dear to my heart, let's talk just briefly about the way that that has become more visible. I think in part, you know, on the Republican side of the spectrum, due to the Koch brothers' advocacy. Do you, I'm curious, since you've been on the inside of the so-called, what do they call it? The
Koch-tipus.
Koch-tipus.
Right.
Do you think that there is a coincidence, given the fact that a striking number of donors in the Koch's network have been prosecuted or been under federal investigation for environmental violations, you know, dumping or, you know, what have you, do you think there's a coincidence, and they have as well, between their advocacy for criminal justice reform, or do you believe it's genuine?
I mean, I don't think that they're mutually, I think that they can coexist, right. That both those motivations can coexist. So, you know, if the Kochs were solely, or some of these extremely wealthy businesses were solely interested in changing the policy in the narrowest ways that it would impact them, they would just lobby on it. They would just spend money on lobbying. They would spend money, you know, whether it was lobbying Congress to change a narrow portion of the rules that would affect them, or they would spend money lobbying the Department of Justice on sentencing guidelines and stuff like that. Instead, you see this very high-profile, risky type of spending that is much more ambitious. So that has a much sort of broader goal and would affect many more people than just corporate criminals or folks who are the subject of corporate prosecution. So, and just more generally, when we talk about this idea of like self-interest in some of this spending, like, the Koch brothers, not to harp on them, but they have become sort of the poster children for this. The Koch brothers are doing fine. Like, they don't need to spend money in elections. They don't need to have, you know, Scott Walker or Jeb Bush or, you know, even Donald Trump. It really makes no difference to them. They've had their most successful, their company, their multinational industrial conglomerate, Koch Industries, has had its most successful run, its most profitable run under President Obama. So, like, it doesn't matter really who's president for them. And they have been spending money extremely effectively, as have all corporations, on sort of less high profile, more effective types of channels to put their money into politics that have a higher rate of return, including lobbying, including limited donations, not these types of huge donations that were authorized, legalized by Citizens United, but limited donations to party chairmen and ranking members on both sides of the aisle who regulate their very narrow corporate their business interests, essentially. And so if it was just about that, I think that they would just continue to do this type of spending that for decades and decades has been really honed as almost like an art by these large corporations across all sectors, not just, you know, oil and gas and hedge funds, but, you know, things that we think of as that there's a tendency by progressives to think of as positive, like green energy or what have you. And so I think that if it was just about self-interest, they wouldn't be spending this type of money this way, because this money does really put a bullseye on their back. They are public figures. Here we are talking about them. I crashed their donor conferences. You know, journalists are trying to pry free information from dissidents within the corporation. Like, they don't need all that. And the reason why they are subjected to that is because they're now spending tens, if not hundreds of millions of dollars in elections and public policy advocacy in a way that really has a questionable benefit on their ultimate bottom lines.
Great. Thank you, Ken. So one of the things that the Kochs have done, which I think is worthy of praise is that they started at the bottom, right? They operated in a grassroots way that Democrats have sort of forgotten how to do by focusing on state legislative races and taking over legislatures one at a time, controlling then the people who draw the congressional lines in most states. And that, I think, is what ultimately helped solidify Republican control of the U.S. House of Representatives. So they work from the bottom. Democrats seem to have sort of been focused on, we've got this blue wall where we win presidential elections because the demographics are better for us, and so let's focus our money on there. Raj, would you agree with that assessment of sort of the differing strategies, and what are you doing to kind of change that and bring the Democrats around to a more bottom-up strategy?
Yeah, I appreciate that, Jeff. And I also should say thank you very much for having us. You know, when Jeff asked me to do this, I know he wanted the top Indian American in New York City, so Preet wasn't available tonight. I did email Preet. He loves your work, as you know, I introduced you to. But I'm happy to fill in for Mr. Barrera. He's busy prosecuting people, which we'll talk about, I'm sure. Yes, exactly.
Just ask him to leave me alone, please.
And I know most of the people on the panel, except for Jack here, and I do, it does crack me up because I'm from Kansas, where essentially being a Democrat was a little bit of an endangered species. We had food tasters when we were in the legislature, and now I live in New York the last 5 years, and I mean, you just can't find a Republican. I mean, you can easier start a hedge fund, and Jack probably started a hedge fund, than you can actually find a Republican. So this is an amazing get that we have someone who's a real life practitioner on the other side. And I will say, you were very kind to go through our bios. It just dawned on me while I was listening to this that I have now accidentally had this unique role in my little slice of American politics, because I've actually lived under small donor financing when I had a $500 limit and I won a very big race for the, and I ended up losing a much bigger race 4 years later, but I won a big race in 2006 in Wichita. We've already talked about the Kochs a lot. I grew up with the Kochs. I went to the Charles Koch Upper School in Wichita. They were neighbors. My mother is actually here, who now lives in New York. They live about half a mile from our house, and so they, those of us, if we wanted to, we could turn the whole panel on the evolution of the Kochs and their political strategy, but there's a lot there. There's a lot. Ken has done a magnificent job of unmasking a lot of that, decoding it. I still think there's a lot of misperceptions on both sides, actually, of what really happens there. I think Ken's eloquent comments at the end sort of get to that. But what I've done now, I realize, is run two races under small donor financing in Kansas for the legislature, run a big race for Congress, and then also raise money for a super PAC and moved $1 million check and all of that. So that perspective, you know, now that I'm a former politician, I used to have a 3-point plan for everything. I'm going to give 5 quick points and then move on. But I'll start with where you asked me a question, Jeff, which is this top versus bottom point. And I'm so glad you raised it. And Ken was talking about in his comments, there is so much obsession about the presidential campaign, and it is like, and it's of course warranted. It is the most important office in the world. It has massive impact. But if I could ask a quick question, how many of you, although this is a very informed audience, know the name of your city council person in New York City? Okay, about half. That is remarkably knowledgeable, and keep in mind this is probably as knowledgeable an audience as I'll certainly talk to in probably this year, but you know, certainly this week. Only half of you know that, and I guarantee you if we went out to 13th Street, it would be about 1 in 100 who actually know their council people. So the point is that, as Jeff was mentioning, comparing politics and understanding American politics through the prism of a presidential election is like thinking that you know retail banking because you work at Goldman Sachs. It is absolutely in its own galaxy. It has dedicated reporters who do only that. And so the notion of understanding through that prism has distorted, in my view, somewhat of the understandings of the way that money actually works. So at the local and state race, Jeff already eloquently talked about how he, was denatured by the political process. I'll talk about that in a second. Take Parsippany, New Jersey. I don't know if there must be folks from Jersey in the crowd. Last year, two companies that had business contracts with the city formed an independent expenditure to then take out people who were their opponents on the city council, and they won. So what you have is that, you know, as Ken was talking about, at the high level, I can, you know, I know Charles Koch. I can tell you he genuinely believes in these principles. Now, you can debate that. But as Ken was saying, that it's not even necessarily, of course there's business interest there, but when you get down to actually away from Wolf Blitzer and the Situation Room and that damn map that they always keep poking at, which never works, you know, despite all the millions they spend on it, the point is that you have to look at the state level, the county level, the local level, and to your point, Jeff, the Democrats and the progressive movement have utterly failed on this point. Barack Obama, now we have to give him credit for the 08 wave, but we have lost 900 state legislative seats in the 2010 ballot. Many of you people obviously were involved probably in 2014. These midterm elections have been devastating to the progressive movement and to the party generally. And so we have often lost sight of that, and the role of money in these, you can't overstate it. So at the presidential level, where you have Donald Trump, they say Donald Trump doesn't need money. Of course he needed the money. He just had 30 years of building himself as a celebrity. That took money. NBC gave him basically an in-kind contribution to a presidential campaign that they didn't know was about to happen once he became a candidate. Of course, to comply with laws, they took him off the TV. So to say that Donald Trump has traction and you don't need money is just not true. He's sui generis, and the presidential cycle itself is not a great way to actually think about how we are governed at the state and local level. Jeff gave me a softball there because I am the chair of the State Innovation Exchange. We fight ALEC in the state capitals. Which is obviously a very generational-long fight, but it's going very well, and it's something that I would recommend you take a look at. I'll just quickly say, it's very on the small donor piece, because I know Adam is going to talk about small donors. So nobody, I think, would suggest that New York City is actually, you know, an Athenian democracy that's governed by the enlightened class. There's a great line in the movie Quiz Show, if you remember, when Charlie Van Dorn has to tell his dad, Mark Van Dorn, he's got to go testify down in Congress. And he goes, Dad, I have to go testify in Congress. He goes, Charlie, you're going to run circles around them. It's not exactly Webster and Clay down there anymore now, is it? And what does he mean by that? The nature of our electeds has actually not been at the level of, you know, obviously we always live think about things through rose-colored glasses. But New York City has the best small donor financing system that Adam's going to praise. But I don't think anybody will say that we live, again, in Plato's Republic here. And so the point is that I believe in small donor financing. I remember when a $50 check was the biggest thing ever, and I remember doing, you know, just like Jeff was talking about, it was a great energizing feeling getting people in a room, not asking for $1,000, which, you know, I made 20,000 phone calls when I ran for Congress, made extraordinary asks of my friends. I know exactly what you're talking about when you see dollar amounts. It is dehumanizing. But small donor financing has not been taken to the level that it needs to in localities and states, and the one person who's doing it is Bernie Sanders. And I think that what's remarkable, and it didn't hit me until I actually was having breakfast with someone who worked on the Sanders campaign, who said there is no finance operation. So for a person like Jack, I mean, and Ken mentioned that is the revolution that Bernie has been talking about. I just couldn't even get my head around that fact. He doesn't do fundraising events. I'm like, what do you actually do then? Oh, do you actually think and talk about policy and actually talk to people? Oh my man. Well, you know, I guess this is what actually. I mean, it's a shocking concept. And so the very last thing I would say is that there needs to be my point, which will be maybe a little bit off message from the others, and about what is needed, is that we can talk about laws and regulations all day. I truly believe, this sounds a little bit pie in the sky, there needs to be a culture change with who actually the elected class represent. So even though my friend Preet can prosecute and put all these people behind bars, does anyone actually think Albany has changed? I mean, there's a great article by Jesse McKinley in the Times that said, Albany is just back to its own games. So we have to elect people, and this is not an endorsement of any candidate in any way, but we do have to actually have more of a investment in who the elected class are. We need all of you to actually know who your city council person is and engage in this, and I'll just end then where Jeff began, which is that's why I believe in investing in city council races and state legislative races. There's too much focus on the national race, and the prism is distorting where actually progressives should spend their time and how we can actually get more functioning democracy.
Thanks very much, Raj. Dr. Greer, you are a keen observer of campaigns and elections, and I'm wondering if you can first, you know, give us kind of your big picture analysis of 2016 as and money so far, and second, if you can talk a little bit about some of the people, some of the inequities of this system. Who's getting left out? I know that's something that you always are thinking about in terms of American politics. Can you talk about that in the context of campaign finance?
Yeah. Oh, gosh. Well, this campaign, I mean, I feel like my PhD is useless. You know, there's so much. I mean, after 2012, so many political scientists were just gearing up for the most boring Bush v. Clinton take two, right? And it was just going to be the 90s all over again, and we were wondering what the media would really do, and you guys were going to try and create an interesting story out of nothing. And then all of a sudden, you know, Trump sort of comes around in the summertime. I was nervous. I will say I was nervous, and most people are like, don't worry about it. But, you know, anytime you share a stage with someone, you should probably take them seriously, right? Hillary Clinton didn't do that in 2008, and we see where she is now. And she didn't do it again in 2015, and we see where she is again. So most people didn't take Trump seriously, and now they must, right? I think what Raj was saying, especially about Obama, keep in mind, Obama had lots of small donations, right? Lots of little grandmas sending in the last $3 they had. Like, let's be clear, Obama's not a Boy Scout when it comes to fundraising either. You know, he's on Wall Street. So I think that's, you know, a lot of people are sort of comparing Obama and Bernie. And Obama mastered the small donation, but he also mastered the Wall Street donation as well. I think Bernie's fascinating because, you know, when he said, I'm coming to New York after his big speech, and not to go to Wall Street. Who does that? What elected official comes to New York and doesn't go to Wall Street? And he hasn't. And so he's shown us that he can get traction. Where that traction will end, I think, is going to be fascinating, right? Because there's the Clintons are, A, their box set, and B, their machine. And we know that even though they might not have as many friends as they think they have, they still know how to get money. And they can squeeze money. They can squeeze an eagle off a quarter. So we know that there's a capacity for the Clintons to show up when it comes to financing. I've actually, as a Democrat, I was fascinated with our former president's speech yesterday on behalf of his brother. It sort of made me miss that type of Republican, which we just don't have in this election right now. And so I'm fascinated with the amount of money that Jeb has been able to raise and just not get the traction. So we're seeing this really interesting moment of party-centered politics, but also candidate-centered politics. And there are these hard skills that candidates have, but then there are these soft skills that we've been trying to sort of wrap our minds around as political scientists. And George Bush, George W. had it, and his brother clearly doesn't. Bill Clinton
has it a different way.
Okay.
I worked for all three of them, so I can say that.
But you know, like Bill Clinton has it.
Had it.
Hillary. he is off the farm these days. But HRC doesn't really, you know, as try as she might. So I've been fascinated about that. So thinking about some of my research, what I'm most interested in are the communities that have a history of giving. And so obviously a lot of my research is on Black American politics. And so Black Americans have a long history of giving to the church, right? There's a long history of economic giving to various organizations, but there isn't a long history of political giving. And for those African Americans who do donate to campaigns, it's usually to presidential campaigns, and it's not to local elections, which to me is where all the action is, because the Republicans are way ahead of the Democrats when it comes to really thinking about state houses, thinking about governorships, thinking about compositions of city councils. Thinking about the pipeline, where I don't know why the Democrats are just so concentrated on, you know, these blue cities and these red states. All 50 states are red states. Do you have enough blue cities in your red state to flip the state blue when the time comes? But the Republicans are just like, okay, so fine. All the colored people are moving to cities, and so are the liberals. All right, you guys can have it. And to a certain extent, they're just like, you guys can have the presidency to a certain extent, fine. But I think that the Democrats are putting way too much stock in this one office and really neglecting all these other areas where the Republicans are just, they're on it. So let's see. I think I'll pause there. Oh, here's my, obviously I'm representing ovaries this evening. So here's my plug for sort of Black women in politics and why it's so difficult for Black women to run. Because oftentimes, and this is, there's literature that
that supports this. Oftentimes when people say they want to support a black candidate, in their minds, they mean a black male candidate. And oftentimes when people say they want a female candidate, in their minds, it's a white female candidate. So black women have a really hard time raising money at the same levels as other candidates based on race and gender combined. And so if we think about all these elections as a pipeline, black women across the country are doing pretty well in state houses, but it's that money that takes you to the congressional race, right? That House race is a totally different sphere. Yeah. And we know that we've only had one black female senator, U.S. senator, in the history of our nation. That's Carol Moseley Braun from Illinois. We have a possibility of getting two more, but this is, we're talking real money right now.
Yeah.
It's much harder for black women on the national, on a statewide level.
Yeah, absolutely.
And zero governors.
And we're actually having lunch Thursday with a woman congressional candidate from right here in New York City who's in a primary against like 6, 7, 8 men, which will be very interesting.
Sort of kind of looks like this.
Yeah. Sorry.
Sure, my students pointed that out. They're like, Professor Greer, Professor Smith has you on a panel with 5 other men. I think I'll be okay.
So, Adam, why don't we, I might should have started with you because I know you can give us a fantastic kind of big picture assessment of kind of like where we are and maybe break it down. I know we have an incredibly well-informed crowd, but for those in the crowd who maybe aren't as familiar with the nuances of Citizens United and Free Speech Now, if you can give us like just a minute or two on how they've those decisions have shaped where we are.
Oh man, I'm not even a lawyer, guys. I'm sorry. First of all, thank you for having us here, and we could do a whole panel on inequality and race and campaign donors. I think it's we had done this study earlier this year where we looked at the first 6 months of presidential fundraising, and it was like three Upper West Side zip codes, Central Park, had given as much money as every single majority African American zip code combined for the first 6 months of the presidential election, which is crazy to me. So that's me stalling so I can talk about how Citizens United and Speech Now have changed things, but I'm going to stall once more and say one other thing I want to start with is that we've been talking about Bernie Sanders and Donald Trump, and sort of what that takes me back to is that the two guys who have been talking the most about money and politics this cycle, whose central message is I am not bought, I'm free of lobbyist influence, won the New Hampshire primary. Bernie Sanders, I think all of us in here could probably recite his message, you know, Wall Street and the millionaires and their contributions and lobbyists rigged the political system and against us, and we need a revolution of millions of donors to fight back, right? We've all heard it. Donald Trump on the other side, with a little more racism and bigotry.
Xenophobia.
There's so much wrong with him. There's lots of bad stuff, but also one of his central messages, whether it's true or not, is I'm self-funded. The lobbyists can't go after me. He's called...
you know that, by the way, is not true.
I absolutely know that's not true.
Just so everybody knows, he is not self-funded. He's taking campaign contributions.
Millions.
But, you know, he sits at debates and he calls, no offense, Jeb Bush a puppet for his donors, right? And so he has made this central part of his campaign, so I think it shows this real public anger that people are coming into, which is about money and politics in a way that we haven't seen before. And I think that partly comes because of the Ken would be a better explainer of the difference between Speech Now and Citizens United, but these sort of decisions allowed all of this, a lot more money to flow into the race. Things were pretty bad before 2010. I don't think anybody could sit here like, oh God, things were so great in 2006, right? But it got a lot worse, and I think what you saw was all of a sudden, a splash across the front page of the USA Today is candidates go to Cokes, right? You have all these stories about these donors like flying to California and Las Vegas and like prostrating themselves in front of these big donors. And I think that people who already have a lack of faith in the political system, this only confirms that for them, that they are going to go and do whatever these donors think, whether it's perception, just perception, whether it's actual corruption, but it really harms our democratic institutions. And I think that the decisions, I'm not talking a lot about process here. The process we can go into, but I think you'll see that 80% of Americans oppose the Citizens United decision. They might not know exactly what it is, but you never see anybody, you never see a Supreme Court decision that people know what it is and have an idea about what it is and have an opinion on it. And so I think the decision and all the money coming in has really impacted people's opinions of how the system works. I don't know if that answered your question.
Well, it didn't, but that's okay. It's in the spirit of this election cycle, right?
That's right. That's fine. I got my
should have been a comedian.
So, Zach, let me ask you, and I also want to talk to Jack about this, but how has Democratic fundraising evolved, over the last several cycles? Do you think that, Democrats should be playing like the same game that Republicans have sort of pioneered, the sort of outside money, super PAC game? I know it was a very difficult decision for President Obama. He's, talked a lot about being sort of conflicted in 2011 when he decided to open up Priorities USA, the Democratic super PAC. Do you think it was a wise move for Democrats to kind of go down that road? Or do you think Democrats should have tried to seize this sort of moral high ground by eschewing, any super PACs and trying to win without it? And then maybe have more standing to take a case to the American people?
Yes. Well, first of all, thank you for having me, Jeff, and Dean Kosheva and Dean DePass as well. I am the Democrat, so I am not wearing a tie. That is my way of distinguishing myself up here. So I apologize for that. Fundraising has changed dramatically in just the 4 or 5 years. I've been doing it when it first started in, a court case that we haven't even discussed, but was also a Supreme Court case, was McCutcheon, a case that basically took away the aggregate limit. So it was, before you could only give to six congressional max to six congressional candidates. This ruling basically said that, the prior thinking was the seventh candidate was somehow going to be the corruption point. And the ruling basically stated, that was not the case, which you can even just see within the writing of that the current limits for congressional campaigns are 2,700. The clear way this is headed, the obvious thing, the first dollar after 2,700, how is that corrupting? And so, you could see the United States Congress be like Missouri and have no limits. That is clearly where this is headed. And then you see the advent of super PAC, so with the Citizens United decision. But one thing that I think is fundamentally misunderstood about super PACs is, and something I'm sure Jack will probably agree with, although that'll probably be the only thing we agree on, is they ultimately empower a group of people, like Ken said, who aren't necessarily the folks in power. And so while they are representing their candidate necessarily, they don't have the authority to speak for them. So in other words, in 2012, John McCain made clear that he did not want to bring up Reverend Wright. That was off the books, and that was not to be discussed. And ultimately, it was probably the wise decision to make. This day and age, you couldn't tell a super PAC donor. You could say on TV, our campaign is, advising against this, or we don't want to say this, but if you have a billionaire that's out there with a super PAC and they want to go after the president for Reverend Wright, they can do that, much to the candidate's dismay. And so, yes, there is a lot of money in politics, but as you're seeing with these candidates, it's the hard money that pays for the 23-year-olds who are spending 11 hours sitting on a desk, that those millions and billions, they are great, and they're great for TV, but as many of you here, when was the last time you watched a TV commercial, they can only go so far. And with Donald Trump, there's no way to take that on at a TV commercial. It's all baked in.
So, Zach, you raise a fascinating point, and that's the arm's length status of a super PAC versus the campaign. And you talked about the fact that sometimes a super PAC would run an ad that the candidate or the campaign itself would prefer not be run. Jack, the super PAC, I know you can't have any dealings, of course, with the super PAC Right to Rise that's raised over $100 million to support Jeb Bush and also oppose his opponents. And I think it's without question that super PAC has sort of changed the tone of the race, because that super PAC has gone after, some of the other Republicans in the race. Has there been any feelings on the campaign of sort of
Well, of course, you think I'm going to answer that question? I mean, I'm not going to speak about the campaign, but what is interesting, I'll say the following. The two largest super PACs in the world, in America today, are Fox and MSNBC. Okay? So we can, if either one of them, it doesn't matter, they're exactly the same on different sides. And it's 24 hours of this straight party line. Okay? So, and there's no regulating that. The other thing that we never want to talk about is, you know, the AFL-CIO is the largest super PAC in America. And they have no limitations on their ability to spend, and they have the ability to take money from people without their wanting to do it. So it's really interesting.
In some states.
What?
In some states,
yeah. So, but they can coordinate with campaigns all they want. So, look, I'm not complaining about it. It's just a system. But it is... I have a fundamental belief about this, which those of you in the room may disagree with. The key on all of this is transparency. You've got to know who the money's coming from, because at the end of the day, an educated citizen can make a determination whether it's on whether how somebody votes, what they say, where they go. If they know, okay, well, if you have the theory that if somebody gives you money, you're going to mean whatever to them. Well, if it's publicly disclosed, you have the ability to vote for them or not vote for them. I mean, I don't necessarily, I'm not involved in any hidden groups, so when we were at the Super PAC, we disclosed all that. At the campaign, not only have we disclosed the $2,700 checks, but we're disclosing the people who signed up to bundle money, which I don't think anybody else is doing. Hillary's doing it.
And Obama did.
Right, yeah. Obama did, and by the way, just so we're clear, the person who started that was George W. Bush in the year 2000. We were the first person to ever disclose that.
Pioneers and
McCain,
the regulars, right?
McCain in 2000.
But we did it first. I know because I was there. I was actually one who designed the program. So it's a really interesting thing because what McCain-Feingold did, and we can argue about whether it's good or bad, was it basically said, okay, the parties now have limitations on the amount of money they can spend. So okay, money people. And this is not my quote, but money is like water. It's going to find its way into politics. And so the question is, do you want to see the water or not and know where it's coming from? And my thesis has always been that that's the best way to make a determination, because then you can make the determination for yourself. I mean, you either like this man or woman who's running for office based on what they voted for, said, and who they've taken money from or not. And, you know, here's the funny thing. The other thing that's interesting about this, which we haven't talked about tonight, if you're Mars and you sell M&Ms, you're happy to not have advertising for another candy. What do you need that? I mean, you own the market. So if you're an incumbent, and it doesn't matter which party you're in, congressman or senator, you're happy with limitations. Why wouldn't you want to have limitations? You've already run for office. You've already won. You're on TV for the only thing. But, you know, Gene Smith, who wants to run against you, who nobody knows, I'm happy to limit what I do. I just limit her, too. Well, how are the citizens supposed to have an opportunity to make a determination if they want to buy a different kind of candy? So when you're really focused on it, the transparency piece I think is critical and very important. And one of the challenges is with super PACs is while they're transparent, they're not the campaign. So it becomes that.
So could I?
Yeah, go ahead, Raj. Then
I'll make a quick point. I know Ken should jump in here. So that's an interesting example of what Jack said. Which is I think an example of the distinction where Jack is sitting versus the establishment Republican Party versus where their activists are. His view on disclosure is not at all the orthodoxy of the other side.
But you know what? It actually was central to the decision in Citizens United.
Absolutely.
And Anthony Kennedy, who wrote that majority decision, who was the swing vote on that, said that, in fact, he said two things that run very parallel to what you're talking about. He said that incumbents have an advantage, and in order for incumbents to face serious challenge, we need the ability for money to come into the system to offset the advantages of incumbency. That was one of the rationale for Citizens United. Another one of the rationales was that with the current state of technology and the regulation of disclosure, that we should be able to instantly find out who is giving this money. Now, I would argue that in both cases, with both of those arguments, and there are other arguments as well that he put forth in Citizens United, he has been proven, and the Supreme Court majority, which included the recently deceased Antonin Scalia, have been proven to be like utterly clueless about the way modern politics works. The disclosure is not happening. He admitted as much.
I'm not he gave
a speech at Harvard where he said there's a line in the decision that says that like. You know, that, you know, people can base their decision upon you have the right to speak and people have the right to know who is speaking. And at Harvard, relatively recently, after the 2012 election cycle, the first election cycle after Citizens United, he said that hasn't worked out as it should, as I had hoped would.
Let me just I'm not going to argue about that. Go ahead.
The other point, though, is that because what's what Ken hasn't said yet. So he's exactly right about the disclosure. We all agree has been a joke so far. But
that's the FEC. Federal Elections Law can change.
Jim Bopp is litigating to do away at the Supreme Court level with the very disclosure requirements that Kennedy used to base that he based Citizens United on. So the point that I'm just trying to make here is that this is another example of the schism on the other side, because everything that Jack said about disclosure is viewed fundamentally as a threat by the leading constitutional practitioner of the Supreme Court on campaign finance regulations. He does not believe what Jack just said.
So let me
Jim Bopp believes disclosure is antithetical to free speech.
Even before that, I mean, you don't have to strike down the laws. The laws as they are currently set up, as Citizens United created them, allow for nonprofit groups and corporations that do not have to disclose, and unions that do not have to disclose where they got their money, to spend money directly on political advertising. This is something that the Supreme Court clearly did not envision, did not understand how it would work out. It's a really like a flaw. To me, it's like kind of surprising, and it argues like, I wonder like who the clerks are who like helped put together that decision. I see my mother-in-law glaring at me.
Read the transcript of
federal public defender. It's true. Like anyone who sort of was following politics would have been able to say, hey, you know, Justice Kennedy, like that's not really the way it's working already. And if this decision comes down as you are now drafting it, it will lead to an explosion of completely undisclosed spending that there is absolutely no way, short of hiding in the bushes or sneaking into the Koch brothers seminars, to find out who the donors who wrote the check to the group that helped elect the member of Congress who then turned around and said, hey, you know what, I'll write a law that will favor that person. That's what Kennedy is saying, that then the voters can vote that person out. Well, you will never be able to find out who wrote the check in the first place, so it's sort of a fundamental flaw in the decision.
So I'm not the defender of Citizens United, for the record, so we're clear about that. I mean, that's not what I'm here to defend. I just want to remind everybody that this didn't start with the Koch brothers. This started with a guy named George Soros, and what's the wonderful guy that is the
Peter Lewis?
Peter Lewis. We also got Peter Ding. And then what's my friend that does the
Action Heroes? Hans Saban.
Yeah. So I sat in 2004 on the other side of this. Okay, so you know it was nobody was screaming about George Soros spending $100 million. It was the greatest thing since sliced bread. So the hypocrisy in this thing is somewhat enjoyable. But it's really. So it's very interesting, and of course there's everything that people said. There are interesting things about all of this, but this is not a Republican problem. This is if you believe this is all bad, it's all bad on both sides. So that's the critical nature of this thing, which is I love the fact that the president struggled with this decision, but had no problem doing it. Either be for it or be against it. I mean, you know, be open about it. That's what I never understood. I mean, I'm not opposed to if the laws are written the way they are right now, this thing will get relitigated. You know it will, because of the things that have happened as a result of this. But it is interesting.
And the change of the court.
Yeah, and change of court, and the potential change of the court, which is a topic I'm not going to discuss tonight.
I'll make one quick point. I like Jack's point is very fair, and I think Democrats should acknowledge it more, which is that there is plenty to go around on both sides of this, so there is no moral high ground, and Democrats love that, and we should get off of that. One last little point. It's not quite, I think, I would disagree a little bit with Ken here about the impact of the ruling and the laws and regulations. It's actually the IRS that is not enforcing the C4 rules, which is allowing the dark money, which Ken is super expert on. But remember that the social welfare organizations, Jack is correct. Every super PAC dollar is disclosed. Every bundled dollar is disclosed. He does get credit for disclosing his bundlers. Everything he's doing is transparent, and he should get credit for that. The dark money, remember, is coming under an exploited loophole in the C4 rules, which the IRS is not enforcing. And so part of the Republican agenda to emasculate the IRS is not only because they hate taxes and they hate actually the government existing, so therefore you want to starve the beast, but it's also they don't want enforcement. So the Lois Lerner scandal was not about that. She was not actually a zealot against one or the other. It was to disembody the notion of IRS enforcement. If the IRS would simply do its job and decry these C4 organizations for being the political beasts that they really are, we wouldn't have dark money.
As you can all see, neither Raj Goyle, Ken Vogel, nor Jack Oliver is low energy. wow. This is
hey, my guy was not low energy last night
your
at all.
Guy, he's, as I've tweeted, he's gotten better with every debate. He didn't start very strong, but he has gotten better with every debate, undoubtedly. So let me ask, though, and this is a question really for everybody, so I want everybody to take their turn. Money just doesn't really seem to have correlated with success.
Right? Sorry.
And
my Rubio moment.
Your point, I think Jack makes a great point. Is my mic off? Okay.
Is this one? The mic's going in and out.
Yeah. But,
it's fine. Okay.
We'll speak loudly.
Okay, I'll speak
loudly.
Seems
to work.
So you make a good point, Jack, that you know the media has a megaphone. Right, and Donald Trump came equipped with a decade's worth of name ID and reputation. But it's even for candidates, who are not situated in the same way that Trump is, money just hasn't seemed to correlate with success in any way, shape, or form so far this cycle. And my question to the panel is, why is that? Is that because some of the super PACs that have spent a lot of money have to pay so much more for their TV ads that they don't get as much bang for the buck? Is it because the technology through which a lot of voters are getting messages isn't really the same as it was, 8 years ago? People aren't watching as much TV or getting their information that way, and like Snapchat and other ways are becoming increasingly prominent. Is it because of just the mood of the electorate is such that when a candidate's on TV all the time, they're perceived to be the establishment choice? Why do you think the money isn't working?
So I think there's a few things. Ironically, actually, about Soros, the problem with some of these super PACs is coordination is a real actual issue. So I can't remember the name of the documentary, but in 2004, there was a documentary that followed America Coming Together, which was, I believe, the 527 Soros-funded that we're referencing here. And they followed these door knockers. They knocked on these doors in Ohio. And the person that answered the door said, I literally just closed the door on a Kerry Edwards person. And so it was the duplication of effort. It was, all of that money sort of went to nothing, really. And so these super PACs, they have hundreds of millions of dollars. And what that does is it keeps people in a race that otherwise they don't have support. I think it was Santorum won Iowa and was in it till the very end last time, when I don't even think people cared. Didn't have that very big base of support. So it keeps them on, in a way that they would otherwise have fallen off completely. But it's hard to reach voters when, like I said, you don't have the ability to have the 23-year-olds knocking doors because you can't pay them. And like I said, TV ads just don't buy what they, and this election cycle in particular, obviously you have candidates like Donald Trump where it's just baked in. People just assume he's going to say the craziest thing. So when he does, you're like, yep, that's sort of what he says. Like, you just sort of know that.
I think it's also really frustrating. The media, I keep calling it the media.
Oops. What a show.
We'll just talk loudly. It's really frustrating because they keep saying, we can't understand the rise of Trump. And then you look on the front page of every single paper.
That's a great point.
But so there have been articles about, these top 10 papers actually have 7 stories about Trump above the fold, each paper. So it's like, maybe you can explain the rise of Trump because all you do is report for 3 days every time he sneezes, let alone says something racist, homophobic, xenophobic, Islamophobic, sexist, whatever it may be. So that's pretty frustrating. I think, someone mentioned it earlier, we can't underestimate Twitter. you know, I'm not on Snapchat and Instagram. I'm too old for that. But like, at least I am on Twitter. And I think a lot of people are also on Facebook as well. But there's sort of Twitter, and then, you know, as someone who studies black politics, there's black Twitter, which is something totally different, that if you're black, you're on it. If not, you're not. So that's a series, well, you dabble. But those are a series of conversations where it's like, these are conversations that people are having about Bernie, right? And he's doing well with sort of black millennials in a way that Hillary Clinton just doesn't have traction at all. No one's buying it. Nobody wants anything that she's selling. And so I think for other people, because Trump is this mastermind of the media and he's been able to sort of test things out for quite some time, he understands how it works. And the fact that he's able to tweet miscellaneous ideas, you can see minutes after he tweets them, they have thousands of retweets that go in just various places. And it's almost like the more outlandish, there are no repercussions for his outlandish behavior. The rules no longer apply, right?
Interesting point. I'm going to say, so this is not me telling you this. This is a public study that was done by, I can't remember who it was, but it's a legitimate group. Donald Trump has gotten 25 times more media impressions than every other candidate, including Bernie Sanders and Hillary Clinton combined.
Wow. Mm-hmm. Wow.
25 times.
That's a great point.
Wow.
I would also say that people, this whole like straw man argument of money doesn't matter anymore has been going around, and so I've been thinking about it a lot. And I think that also candidates matter.
Yeah.
Right? We can say someone has all the money in the world, but they're a candidate that nobody wants. Well, I'm not going to say that, but
Got a good new tracking poll out of South Carolina. Yeah. We're in second place. So.
That's right. Yeah. So a lot of other candidates
just got it on Twitter.
A lot of other candidates with money have already left the race. Candidates matter. I mean, candidates matter, and the time matters. And the thing is, if you are a good candidate, then you better have that money behind you to help you make your case. And I think going back to Raj's point earlier is, if you're a member of Congress and you have to raise $2 million this cycle, and then you're a competitive seat and you have a $2 million threat from AFP coming at you, I don't think they're going to be able to tell you that money doesn't matter. They're going to be day in and day out, 8 hours a day at the call room making calls. So while the presidential race, a lot of people have a lot of money, and so a lot of people are able to keep going, the it'll matter a lot more as you go down the ballot.
And if I could just make 2 points on the money doesn't matter sort of hypothesis being applied to this particular presidential race, where you have two candidates who have not spent as much money. I mean, whether Trump is raising his money from other people or he's spending his own money, he spent a fraction of the amount of money as other candidates have. And Bernie Sanders spending a fair amount of money, but raising it in a very different way, through small donations online, in a way that is sort of like what Raj and Adam have suggested, the ideal of any legislation that would encourage small donors, while he's doing it on his own without the legislation. But to say that money doesn't matter, even in this election cycle, is wrong. I mean, Ted Cruz won the Iowa caucus. He won the Iowa caucus in large part because he had these group of super PACs that had $40 million behind them that were doing extremely sophisticated voter targeting, micro-targeting, canvassing, persuasion. They literally use this like algorithm that this firm that is owned by a Cruz mega donor established for them, to using like Facebook data, using polling data, using like actual outreach, canvassing, knocking on doors, calling these people to determine. There are 90 people who, like, we need to persuade to win the Iowa caucus. 90 people who are deciding between Trump and Cruz, and that's a 180-vote swing if they all go to one way or the other. And they went out and they have people who are paid, full-time employees of these super PACs, and they knocked on their doors and they knocked on their doors and called them and won over enough of them. And this isn't, you know, this is, I'm sure there is some element of sort of backpatting here going on. I'm getting this from Cruz sources who are telling me about this effort. But it was, there's no question that it was hugely influential, and it was funded by tens of millions of dollars from a handful of very wealthy folks. So it is having an impact, even if it's only sort of at the margins. Second of all, setting aside the electoral consequences of the individual vote tallies in specific nominating events, it is having an impact on the way Congress and the way these state legislatures approach any number of issues. From, you want to talk about the conservative efforts in the state legislature, look at the right to work, this legislation that has made it more difficult for unions to organize and raise money. that is a result of years and years of very assiduous work, courtship of recruitment of candidates, putting money behind candidates, getting candidates into office, working those candidates once they're in office. Look at the U.S. Congress. I mean, after the 2010 Tea Party wave, you had this caucus of members in the U.S. House of Representatives, Republican members, who refused to go along with what John Boehner, with what the Republican leadership wanted them to do, which was to approve this bill to fund the government to avoid a shutdown. They said, like, well, I don't need you. I don't need John Boehner. John Boehner didn't help elect me. Like, the Koch brothers or the Club for Growth, they're the ones who help elect me because there is this new freedom for them to spend unlimited money in a way that they weren't able to do previously, money that used to go to the parties, not going to the parties, going to these outside groups, electing people who then have absolutely no incentive to go along with difficult decisions that the party leadership are asking them to make and are willing to thumb their noses at the party leadership because some outside group wants them to do so. I think you can trace a direct line from Citizens United to the government shutdown to the efforts to, defund Obamacare, which was sort of linked to the government shutdown. So that is a very real way in which money has had an impact on politics and will continue to for the foreseeable future, even if the biggest, the best funded candidates, Hillary Clinton, Jeb Bush, one of them doesn't win the presidential race.
So we've seen a little bit of a kind of full circle in terms of what super PAC money actually does, right? As Jack alluded to, in the first cycle in which independent expenditures were prominent, almost all of the money went towards field efforts, right? Canvassers that worked on behalf of John Kerry in the 2004 election. Then when independent money came back, it came back really strongly in the 2012 race with Mitt Romney's super PAC only doing TV, no field efforts, just sort of pure TV and almost all negative. I don't know if Restore Our Future even ran a single positive ad about Romney. Now, this cycle, it's been a mix. Okay, some of the money has gone, as Ken alluded to, towards field efforts and like more sophisticated kind of micro-targeting and data analytics, and other money has gone towards the airwaves. Where do you guys see super PAC spending going in the future?
Actually, if I could jump on that, a little bit of interesting sort of news, which is in the Asian American community, which I haven't raised so far, and I guess as I alluded before, I'll be the token on that one. We have started, friends of mine, groups that people I know quite well and that I'm involved with, they started an API Victory Fund, and it's a super PAC. So that's actually a broader Asian American, not just South Asian American. And so I said, oh, with super PACs, you're going to run ads. To put into your question, I was like, well, because of the because of the best ad rate rule, the super PACs aren't that effective. And he said, no, actually, the logic of this super PAC is actually just to grab larger checks. All disclose the Jack's point. These are all good people who want to energize the Asian American community. And it's going to be targeted by swing Asian American voters in swing states, so that the argument can be made on election day in Colorado, in Virginia, in Nevada, in Ohio. There were newly mobilized Asian American voters, and they've made the difference. So the goal of that, I don't think anyone would disagree, that's really awesome democracy there. Here's a marginalized community who haven't really turned out at the rates they should. We're going to fund them. We're going to register them. We're going to turn them out. The vehicle's a super PAC. And so it's actually not the Cruz stuff is actually intellectually fascinating in how they target their voters. But I think probably I'm going to presume everyone in this room would love the goals of the API Victory Fund, even though it's using a vehicle that we might instinctively think is a vehicle that feels distasteful to us. So I actually, to answer your question, I think we don't know because the world is sort of changing rapidly, and every cycle that we've talked about, it's morphed. And so what we really have to do is to get back to Jack's point, which is if there is true disclosure and transparency, judge them on the merits of their work. And so I think we could say that probably the C4s and the 527s doing the dirty money, the undisclosed money, just basically attacking, I think we can all say probably not great for the system. But if there's other legal disclosed channels that are under the rules and they're doing good work for that is fair game, I don't think we could rightfully criticize that.
Interesting, because we've seen sort of new frontiers this cycle, like Carly Fiorina's super PAC was like literally crowd building for her events. Right. Yep. So
which is not a good sign.
Not a good sign. But definitely like just one more sort of, kind of effort to knock down the walls between candidate and super PAC. Adam, you were nodding a minute ago.
Oh, no, you're right. I mean, the coordination rules are a joke. I mean, I know that he... Not completely, but... Right. With the FEC, that's sort of like not going to do anything, especially with the new... I'm not going to say that. The FEC is not going to do anything. I think that the coordination rules are sort of a joke. I know that Jack doesn't coordinate with the Super PAC, but Jeb went to 60 fundraisers for the Super PAC as he was unofficially running for office for 6 months, right? And so like these people know the donors, and so I'm not actually as concerned about the coordination between strategy, but the tightness that the candidates have with the donors that they talk to. I mean, if a donor gives $5 million to your Super PAC, and you know that. And so when they call you up, you get them extra access and influence. Like, there's no distinction there between whether, no, you just gave the Super PAC, I'm not going to talk to you, right? So that sort of stuff doesn't happen. That's the stuff that I'm actually more concerned about when it comes to coordination.
That makes sense.
And I should say, like,
you were named there, Jack, if you want 30 seconds for a rebuttal.
Yeah, you talk about like the coordination rules. This is another sort of key tenet of the Citizens United decision that has not borne itself out in actual reality. And that was that the decision said that this unlimited spending, this new unlimited spending that the Supreme Court was legalizing, would not have a corrupting influence on politicians or politics because it was independent, and as such, it would not influence have any impact on politicians wouldn't like return a favor to someone who gave to the Super PAC because the Super PAC was different from their campaign. As we've seen, it's in some ways it's sort of functionally indistinguishable, the Super PAC versus the campaign. So it's yet another sort of flaw in the reasoning, not the legal reasoning behind Citizens United. I think the legal reasoning probably, you know, people may quibble with the result, but the legal reasoning was pretty sound and I think will be difficult to overturn. But the actual practical impacts, I think, were mispredicted, that they got it, they didn't realize how it would actually play out. And one of the key ways is this coordination thing. So you see constantly the campaigns are calling me up and they're saying, oh, did you see what the Bush Super PAC and the Bush campaign did? Or did you see what Hillary's doing with her Super PAC? You should write a story about how that's a violation of the coordination rules. And in some ways, it may look from a lay perspective to be a violation of the coordination rules, or at least the intent of the rules. But because the rules are so narrowly written, in fact, these campaigns and the Super PACs, for the most part, are all operating within the sort of narrow rule, legally, and not doing anything certainly that would allow a rules violation or a prosecution of them for violating these coordination rules.
Jeff, I feel my issue with one of my many issues with Super PACs, though, is that it also replicates this cycle of like white male politics and conversations, right? And so we know that the vast majority of these Super PACs are sort of white male, incredibly wealthy millionaires/billionaires. And so it takes women out of the conversation, it takes people of color out of the conversation, and it sort of replicates this historical, racist, sexist, political schema that we have, you know? And so the same way I wrote an op-ed about the issue with presidential internships and how they're somewhat problematic because they don't pay. Bernie's the only presidential candidate who actually pays his interns. And so you have sort of young white boys who are able to volunteer for these campaigns because their parents can sort of finance them and, you know, put them up in donor housing or whatever it may be. And so for a year or maybe even a year and a half, they can work for free. And so then if and when their candidate wins, they're just sort of elevated into the administration from a campaign perspective, which continues to leave out women and people of color systematically. So that's also my issue with sort of these super PACs. Yes. Of course, these people know that someone gave them $5 million. So again, we're just in this kind of heteronormative white male space that excludes so many people from real, sort of real politics.
And I think one of the problems with the current Supreme Court sort of jurisprudence on corruption is that it's a quid pro quo. They say quid pro quo is the only kind of corruption that matters, and we're not talking about political equality at all. Mm-hmm. And I think that this system leads to this, I mean, political equality and economic equality, they're all tied together, and you have the system like you talked about where the current system puts rich white people ahead of everyone else. And the stat I said earlier, where you know the three white district zip codes gave as much as every single majority black zip code. And
there's also this belief in the system, yeah. right? Like I paid into yeah. the system because the system does work for me. This is sort
right.
of the
and you look at
a lot of people and many
system,
people.
I will say, by the way, it's a bunch of folks from Wall Street who did very well there, obviously, in yeah. order to give these contributions, and they've ultimately invested in folks and fundraisers who had one of the poorest returns on investment I've ever seen.
Yep.
They spent $100 million in 2012 and mm-hmm. lost all those Senate races. So the idea that Karl Rove can continue to ask these people for the sums of money he asked them for when they've gotten returns on Wall Street of so much money, and yet still it's amazing to me how poorly they have worked.
But I agree with you completely. But we also need to make sure we're clear on people on Wall Street are making their money off the backs of poor yep. black and,
no,
and white and Latino people,
those are not
right?
Mutually
so it's like, so then we also have this whole complete replication of the system where it's like you are literally making your money bundling bogus, you know, mortgages off of poor people, and then this also buys you even more access to politicians after you've sort of screwed financially the American public.
And I think when you're spending like 8 hours a day raising money, you can't help but be influenced by your friends, right? Like you listen to what your friends say. So if all, you know, Senator Chris Murphy has this great line where he talks about, he hears a lot more about carried interest in the call room than he does when he's at the grocery store. And so you can't help but be influenced by the people that you talk to all the time. So if the people you talk to all the time are all wealthy white guys, you might think the priorities of wealthy white guys are what other people think about and not everybody else.
All right. On that note, I want to take a few questions from the audience. I have a couple more things to ask these guys, and I want to tell the people who are live streaming that if you tweet a question to hashtag politics and policy, then I may ask one of your questions up here. Go ahead.
Cool. Hi. I work in local politics, and I'm working for two black candidates, both women, in Brooklyn.
So,
nice.
So in the city, minority politics is more than alive and well. And I just saw that Beyonce and Kanye are starting a SuperPAC.
Yeah.
Are they?
The news of the night.
Yes. Up till now, the primaries have been all white, are the voters. Next week, South Carolina is voting, and then Super Tuesday with substantial numbers of African-American voters. Do you think those voters will make the difference in selecting the Democratic candidate, or whether black voters aren't that engaged in this primary round?
So two things. One, we have to remember that it's black women who put Obama in the White House twice, right? Overwhelmingly so data supports it. This time around, there are a few things going on, right? Like, Hillary Clinton isn't that exciting. She's not. And so there, a lot of black voters are sort of torn between sincere versus strategic voting. So there's some people who definitely agree with sort of the new rhetoric of Bernie Sanders, right? He hasn't said it for 30 years, but hey, the last 5 months he said it about prison reform and all these other things. And that's interesting, that's great, but let's be clear, African-American voters are incredibly strategic voters, and so they're actually thinking about November. So turnout is sort of low in this democracy, sort of all around, but in a general election, African-Americans percentage-wise vote at higher rates than whites. So the issue, though, really is, will people bother to turn out for two candidates that aren't that exciting? One has no connection to the longstanding sort of black American community, if you can even call it that, right? And then the other one has a shoddy record. And like, let's be clear, many people in South Carolina do remember what Bill Clinton said in 2008, but they may strategically vote for Hillary Clinton. Don't forget, when Obama won South Carolina, Bill Clinton says, ugh, I mean, anyone can win South Carolina. Jesse Jackson won South Carolina, which he did in 1988. So many people have not forgotten that, but strategically they might vote for her anyway because they're thinking about who she could possibly beat in November. Bernie Sanders, many African-American voters don't think that he's a viable option in November. So New York City politics, we sort of can use that as an anomaly. Because I don't even say the word minority because people of color are the majority in city council and they're doing pretty well. Those are my thoughts. I mean, I think we have to really think sincerely versus strategically, but it's all about turnout and whether or not you have a candidate who can actually motivate people to come out on Super Tuesday or whatever day, right? There are a lot of people who also talk about sort of voter apathy. I actually think it's more like voter fatigue. Like if you think about New York voters, we're being asked to vote four times this year. In April 19th, don't forget, right? And then June, for our primaries and for many districts, it's the primary is the race, right, for our congressional districts, then in September for our state races, and then in November. So some people are just like, well, I mean, I'm voting in November. Like, you know, you got it for me. That's enough. They don't realize that it's actually, you need to turn out four different times for four really important races that are completely separate.
Ma'am?
Assuming they're competitive races.
Please don't knock the IRS. I am a retired CPA and also a retired teacher.
Yeah.
And since 1980, the IRS has never been fully funded for their budget. And I know people who work there, and they are very sincere, hard workers, but they can't do it. They don't have the money.
Right. So I agree with you. The Republicans have
It's asking
the IRS
to be
budget.
Treated like that woman whose name I don't remember at the chair.
Lois Lerner, right.
I'm glad you raised that question. I mean, you know, obviously there is no more, there is no starker federal agency that displays the schism of government philosophy than the Internal Revenue Service. So there is going to be, you know, even mentioning the IRS talks, you know, suggests ideology. So I agree with you 100%. I thank all, you know, teachers, you know, federal workers who do great work. The Republican Party has a very clear philosophy to not fund the IRS.
Yeah. If
there are plenty of Democratic tax dodgers who talk to their
Congressmen. Right. It's not just that.
That's a different point. Democratic tax dodgers agree with you, but we're talking about who's funding, and the Democratic budgets have always called for greater funding for the IRS and for enforcement. So there is a clear distinction there. I'm talking about who fund. You raised the point of funding the agency, and the Republicans have been clear about starving the beast and not funding enforcement of the IRS, and the Democrats have supported that.
But it's not just funding. I mean, the rules that Raj alluded to that allow for an organization to set up as a nonprofit organization under this Section 501c4 of the tax code, those were written in like the 20s, and those are written for like Elks clubs and like the NFL. I think the NFL is a 501c4. And so they did not envision Citizens United, and they did not envision that Karl Rove would start an organization or the AFL-CIO would start an organization under Section 501c4. Exclusively to mask political spending so that they would not have to reveal who was giving them the money to fund those ads. So yes, there's a problem with enforcement. You could argue that maybe some of these groups the IRS should have brought a test case against one of these groups that was doing this type of thing, but the rules aren't really clear. They might have wasted even more money going after Karl Rove's group and lost because the rules did not envision this. So, you know, is it the Supreme Court's fault for passing a law that allows 501c4s, or rather, you know, issuing a decision that allows 501c4s to spend this money in this way? Is it the IRS's fault for not rewriting the rules after the decision? Is it Congress's fault for blocking funding for enforcement? Who's to say? I mean, it's a structural issue that is clearly the reality. Again, like I've alluded to with the decision, with the Citizens United decision, has so far outstripped what how this system was originally envisioned, that the IRS really is out of its league. It should not be policing this. It should be the Federal Election Commission, and even it has all kinds of problems. So, you know, regulation, I'm not like optimistic that there's going to be any uptick in regulation. I'm not optimistic that there's going to be any, Adam may differ with this, but that there's going to be any real like public backlash that will prompt the political will for there to be like a serious change to the system that would rein in some of this type of spending or more heavily regulate it or require increased disclosure. Typically, where we've seen there. Being situations that have prompted significant reforms, it's because there was some huge scandal. There was Watergate. There was illegal corporate money flowing into President Nixon's reelection coffers. Or there was the Clinton scandals in the 1990s that helped lead to the McCain-Feingold law that prohibited the parties from taking this money. I just think we've all kind of gotten like a little bit immune, maybe that's not that we've gotten like inoculated, so we throw around these sums like $7 billion and people are like, eh, whatever, you know, like we're not like, there's no scandal that's going to really prompt the people to really get involved in this issue in a big way that's going to make it a top voting issue that's going to force members of Congress or a new president to really address.
I saw that play out in 2014 with anyone who lived in a state with a competitive Senate election could tell you exactly the name of all the major, you know, any major donor.
And it didn't really make a difference.
I was saying, and if you listen to my bio, all of them went on to lose. So yes, it doesn't actually matter. Unfortunately, voters don't seem to care.
I don't, the people who, you might, after Donald Trump wins a few more primary elections, we might have a discussion about whether people care about this issue.
Yeah. Sir?
I have two separate subjects. One is about the 2010 election. And the fact that the Democrats ran away from Obamacare. And what did that do to the election in as far as Congress is concerned? And the second was something that was talked about is bringing out the vote an antidote to the dollars?
I'll maybe take that. Since I was on the federal ballot in 2010, I'll take that first question. And this is like PTSD politically for me to relive that. So I am close with Governor Sebelius. She was my Secretary Sebelius, as you would know her. She was my governor, my political mentor. She obviously, in fact, the day the bill, the ACA passed, she was due to be in Topeka to do a fundraiser for me. And she called the day before saying, I think we've got something big going on in Washington. I can't be out of town. We worked so hard. My parents are physicians. They came from poverty in India through medicine. We revere medicine in our family. And I was told by my own advisors, who are all Democratic stalwarts, you must oppose Obamacare. It is upside down in your district. Obama is upside down in the district. You got to run away. And I said, I just can't do that, because to run against medicine and to run against health reform, I don't even want to, you know, and I'm not saying I was some great principled person. I'm sure I made compromise on other issues that I cannot compromise on. We spent, I remember, a five-hour meeting trying to hone sound bites to explain Obamacare. I got it down to 37 seconds, and I'm decently good at this game, but that was something coherent that I said, I didn't like the process of the bill, but I did think that we need reform, but there's three things in the bill I didn't like, and then about I was like, this is just garbage. So there, the message of what we could, so it wasn't a question of running away from Obamacare. It was extremely hard to explain. It was horrifically handled by this White House. You know, a great what if I'll just throw out here is that, do you remember that Tom Daschle was going to be HHS Secretary and White House healthcare czar? He didn't get appointed because Tim Geithner had a tax issue. Then Daschle had a tax issue, and the White House had viewed they had too many ethics hits coming, so they let Geithner get through, and they didn't let Daschle get through, and they cut him off, and they ended up bifurcating that strategy. The great historical what if is, what if we had had Tom Daschle in? He would have gotten a bill through in about 3 months, and we wouldn't have had Tim Geithner's Treasury Secretary. Boo.
So I've got it. I don't mean to interrupt.
So I'm just going to quickly say, we tried very hard, sir, and there were really, remember, there were many Democrats who voted against the bill. It was structurally hard on the federal ballot that year to explain the issue. And remember that Obamacare, to this day, remains upside down in the polls. So even if people like it, it is an unpopular law. A majority of the country is still against it.
So I'm going to say something very interesting. Before they went out of recess in August, the president, this is the year that they passed Obamacare, the president had Chuck Grassley down to the White House. This is all public information. And said, here, we can do about 70% of what you want to do. And if you do this, I'll get you 70 votes. Think about history, how history would have been different than that happened. Because you would have had Republicans on the bill. It probably wouldn't have been as big a bill, but you would have gotten a bill through in a bipartisan way. Which would have been interesting, because it would have changed the whole conversation.
Or if Ted Kennedy hadn't died, then they would have potentially gotten the full single payer.
Anyway.
I don't see that. Yeah. But I think that it's just interesting because when you have major legislation that doesn't have one party person from the other side, this always happens every time.
And it very, very, very rarely is major legislation passed this way.
Yeah,
major overhaul of social policy has been done with, you know, civil rights, voting rights, Medicare, Social Security, yeah. Welfare reform. If you look at like the
Clean Air Act, Richard Nixon,
the last 50 years, they've usually had some bipartisan support.
But like, let's also be clear, this president, you know, knew that he was in a race against time. It's like he's got 2 years because the Republicans are like, we will never work with you, right, black man.
Let's hold on. I will say one thing very interesting. I had a friend of mine who is a Democratic senator who told me a month ago, 6 years into this White House, he had never been upstairs in residency. The president's challenge is not that he doesn't do it with just with Republicans. He doesn't do it with anybody.
No, that's not what. Unfortunately for him, he doesn't realize that so much of politics he does not like to play. So that's an issue that he's had with his.
That's governing. That's having a relationship with somebody.
Why can't it be both?
So that when you pick up the phone and call them and ask them for a vote,
is Mitch McConnell the first thing he said on the Senate floor was that he was going to make this one man like?
I'm not suggesting.
I'm not saying he's great, but I'm also saying he's not exactly playing ball with the.
No, I don't disagree with you, but.
Defend my president.
But what I'm saying, I'm not criticizing your president.
No, I know.
Okay, look, I mean, he's a very talented person. I mean, and what I don't understand is why they haven't made early, not now. I understand now, but early on, why? I mean, think about this. Everybody wants to be. There's no question. People have very strong opinions about my former boss George W. Bush, but without Ted Kennedy and his relationship, I mean, we went way out there with him. And helped him had us write an education bill that, frankly, not all the Republicans loved, but it was a bipartisan piece of legislation that we felt was very important to the country. So, give you another example: AIDS policy. Okay, so George W. Bush doesn't get a lot of credit for this. Last year, Bill Clinton left office. They spent $510 million on funding an anti-vaccine that was sent over to Africa. The president got very focused on this, and with Malaria No More and the PEPFAR. We fundamentally changed how AIDS policy is engaged on a global stage. $5 billion was spent in the president's last year in office. And it wasn't just Republicans. It was Republicans and Democrats. When you can get Jesse Helms and Ted Kennedy to agree upon something, you actually can make progress. And that's what I think. And by the way, that's one of the reasons the American people are frustrated. And that's why you have Donald Trump and Bernie Sanders, is because they don't see anybody working together on anything.
So, and I'm going to just very briefly address the gentleman's first question, which was, can the power of people trump big money in politics? And I did a study, actually, of the Missouri legislature. And I looked at every piece of legislation, what interest groups had supported those bills, and then got the data from several legislators to see how many people had contacted their office in support of or in opposition to a bill. And what I found was pretty interesting was that when constituents don't contact their legislators, then money usually carries the day. Then bills that are backed by money tend to pass, bills that are opposed by money tend to fail. Once constituents get active, with this few, we found that once there's just eight contacts, just eight people who call an office, contact an office and say, we don't like that bill, it's overwhelmingly likely to fail. And similar numbers, a little bit more, about once there's a dozen contacts in support, then it becomes overwhelmingly likely to pass. So a really, I think, sanguine finding about the power of people to be citizen advocates, even in the face of a lot of money in the process. Thanks for the question. Yes, Mr. Singer, former intern of mine.
Ah. Oh. Something, for some reason, I still keep on my resume.
That is a band of courage and principle.
Yeah, I get that off there right away.
So I have a question for Adam.
Yeah.
So Adam, there's been a lot of talk about transparency and potential solutions. New York was thrown out as an example of where things are working. And I think I got re-politicized and joined the Money in Politics movement, worked for Mayday.
Yep.
When a homelessness organization I was working for in Chicago, a city government that doesn't work quite as well, was defunded by the state right after the Democratic governor had pushed for an income tax increase to continue funding human services, which were then slashed anyway, and the Mercantile Exchange gave $100,000 to Rahm Emanuel's campaign for mayor, which everyone knew was happening, and then got $500 million in tax handouts from the state. And this was all transparent. So looking at New York and looking at the rest of the country, what is the real solution here?
It's a really good question. For the past 10 minutes, I'm thinking about how I'm going to talk about it or interject. I think that transparency is really important. But when you threw a camera down in the Deepwater Horizon spill, the oil didn't stop flowing, right? You could just see that the oil was there. And so I think it's really important when you think about transparency, it's really important. But and this has been all really depressing, right? Like, billionaire super PACs. But stuff is actually happening. People are passing laws. Initiatives are going through. through. In November, 63% of voters in Seattle voted to create this voucher system of small donor public financing. Every registered voter is going to get four $25 vouchers. They can give the city council candidates of their choice to agree to participate in the system. And it's going to democratize elections like we've never seen before.
But if you're already a city councilman, and you're running against somebody, and you limit the amount of money they can raise, and therefore
you have to agree to participate voluntary system.
But it doesn't matter if you're someone said a brilliant thing about Donald Trump. He had a TV show for 10 years. If he's running for city council and you're running against this gentleman right here who nobody in Seattle knows, and you give each other and you limit his ability to have his voice, it's like, look, here's a little dirty darn secret. If you run a major corporation, you have a market share. If somebody said all the advertising's off the air, they'd be like, fine. Because I own the market already.
It becomes a political strategy point, but there's a reason that like 80% of the Connecticut legislature was elected using the public financing system. It works and people like it. And in Maine this year, Maine also passed a system that will increase transparency. It'll add groups will have to put their top three donors on their on all their ads, which is interesting. And it also fixes the public financing system. Let me get this right here. 16 states have passed anti-Citizens United resolutions. Nearly 700 localities have. 24 states have strengthened disclosure requirements, including in Montana, which has a Republican-controlled legislature. So while it looks like Washington is sort of like just fighting with each other, people actually are coming together and they are winning these battles. And I think that we're going to see this, and I know for a fact you'll see several more ballot initiatives and maybe one or two legislative fights this year on these issues, and I think you're going to see more of these fights happening. I'm a big fan of small donor public financing. It has worked. You have people like Tish James in office here because she was able to do that. And if you look at the donor base in New York City, the New York City system, I'm not going to say it's perfect, but when you look at the donor base there, it is more. It reflects the diversity of the city than people who run privately in New York for Congress. And I think stuff like that's really important. And I'm just gonna say one more time, you're gonna look at the states and look at the cities, and that's where we're gonna see real movement on this, and it's gonna start to build up.
Raj, quickly.
A very quick point, just to echo Adam. We know with our work with Six, every voice is doing tremendous work. There's another group called Issue One, which is doing awesome work, getting Republicans engaged on this issue. So if Jeff and I took a secret poll of our former colleagues, we know many, many Republicans who are elected officials because of the states we were in, 90% of them would be for reform because they hate the system as much as anybody because it's such a pain and it's not why they're in the system. But I will say, to echo Ken's point, I personally don't think widespread reform happens without a scandal. I think John McCain has been on the record because, of course, he was singed by the Keating 5 scandal himself. I think there could be, I know this might be a little depressing, a deep foreign money scandal that eventually works its way into our system because it'll be too enticing, too easy, a shortcut. Someone, maybe not for president, because there's a lot of transparency there, but maybe on the Senate race or something where there is going to be actual foreign money that flips an election and people will be too horrified that the plutocracy has won here and there will actually be, what Ken was eloquently saying, an actual grassroots uprising to go with all the elites in this room who understand the need for reform.
And politicians need to talk about solutions, right? We have so overwhelmingly won the argument about whether money influences politics that we've almost won it. Like, I'm mad that we won it too well, right? Because everybody's so cynical. So people need to also talk about solutions, not just say what the problem is.
Ma'am?
Yeah, you just brought up the issue of foreign money. Yes. I generally don't need one.
You brought up the issue. I think it's on. Is it on?
Yes.
You brought up the issue of foreign money. Mm. Well, isn't that, to some extent, already influencing the Clinton Foundation? Takes money from people all over the world, and in fact, I believe Mr. Vogel here well aware of the foundation taking money, I believe, Morocco, and from other places where there are extraordinary violations of human rights, of women's rights. Now, if, as Secretary of State, I don't know what she was taking from the foundation, but in taking money from foreign governments for their foundation, doesn't that have an influence? And will that not have an impact on decisions when she is president?
If. Please say if.
I'm not voting for I just want you to know.
Yeah,
but you couldn't tell.
Nor for the Dauphin.
Oh, my gosh, yes.
So anyway, I think there are many ways to get money into the political process, and it's not just through these means that we're talking about. It's not just through disclosed money. It's not just through undisclosed money. It's not just through lobbying or through individual contributions to the people who run these congressional committees. You can spend money. You can give money to a foundation. The Clinton Foundation is, you know, it's a charitable institution. It does a lot of good things around the world, but there is also no doubt that it had been sort of the foundation, the platform through which the Clintons sort of remained, you know, kept a hand in politics for years, independent from any political campaign. So as to the question of whether this would influence Hillary Clinton if she's elected president, I mean, it's tough to say. These are, you know, you raised the Morocco thing. I actually went to a Clinton Foundation meeting conference in Morocco, and Bill Clinton.
POLITICO's budget's going right? great.
And Bill Clinton is like buddies. He went to Georgetown. He's buddies with one of the Saudi princes who runs the intelligence service. His name is Turki Al-Faisal. He's like buddies with him. So like, does the Saudi government or the Saudi royal family need to write a $10 million check to the Clinton Foundation for this guy who went to Georgetown with Bill Clinton to be able to pick up the phone and say offline, hey, you know, there's this issue that we think that your wife, the president, should take a look at? Like, I don't know. It certainly doesn't hurt the ability of any entity that wants to, you know, curry favor with the Clintons to be able to give to the foundation. So, I mean, I don't have the answer, but I do think that to your point, there are many ways to spend money in politics to get access and curry favor that don't necessarily show up in a federal election commission report.
But as you said, then the next day you vote against them. So you have to take, you know, you can take their checks, you can take their money, but the next day you vote against them, you do, you know.
Absolutely. So thank you, Zach. So we're going to close with a quick lightning round. You can only answer with one word. Who's the last Republican establishment candidate left standing?
Jeb Bush.
Rubio.
Bush.
Bush.
Media exemption. Can't answer.
You won't be surprised with my answer.
Yes.
Jeb will be.
Who's the Republican nominee?
Donald Trump.
Donald Trump.
Listen, never discount the Bushes till the last vote's counted. So.
I was going to be nice. You were... I wasn't going to bring up that. I was sitting here. I said, now listen, you had a great story about the foreign money. I was like, I wasn't going to bring up Al Gore going to that temple for the fundraiser.
You know, yeah, if you look up backhanded compliment in the dictionary, right there. Raj?
Cruz.
He's going to say, I'll just be very candid. I think Jeb will be the nominee. It's going to take a long time. If what you notice is Trump gets about 30% in a lot of these meetings. If you look at the establishment candidates, they all get, if you put them together, they beat him every time. The challenge is right now, they're going through the process of having that conversation. When eventually it comes down to one of them, it'd be Jeb. Jeb versus Trump. We'll take that all day long.
Democratic nominee?
Clinton.
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 Kerry.
An indictment, you think?
No, I'm kidding. I don't know. Democrat. I don't know that. But here, think about it. I mean, I tell you, a lot of people are sitting around their living room. They're saying, "Okay, I wish it would have run."
Oh, yeah, absolutely. And Biden as well. And
yeah,
Biden as well. Next president of the United States of America.
I think Donald Trump is understated as a candidate, but I do think Hillary wins.
Hillary.
Clinton.
Clinton.
Bush.
Well, one thing we can say, at least no one called anyone a liar on stage tonight. So a big round of applause for all of our panelists. Yeah.
Thanks, Jeff.
Thank you.
All right.
Thank you, guys. You were awesome.
Thank you, Jeff.
I know. So good to see you. Yeah.